There is a fine line between great brands and passable ones. Is it vision, differentiation, or exquisite design that makes a great brand? Maybe, but I think brands that's been found on the sole purpose of finding solutions more than anything else are the ones that worth a good deal of admiration. Only if you measure success by its good impact rather than swelling revenue. The neatly simple, remarkably creative, or innovative Lacoste is a brand that stays head and shoulders above the rest when it comes to authenticity, invention, and social goals, as opposed to other brands that lose their values throughout the journey of exposure. So backward into a time not too distant from our own, there was a man called Jean-René Lacoste, the winner of 7 Grand Slam titles and world number 1 tennis player during mid-20s. Lacoste, aka the Crocodile, a nickname given to him by the journalist George Cairns, mindful of his voracious and persistent performance on the court, and due to a bet the journalist witnessed between René and his tennis team captain on a crocodile suitcase, that if René won a match, the captain will buy him the expensive case. It turns out that René lost the bet, but the croc idea struck the right chord in René's imagination. René's eureka moment came to realization by the illustrator Robert Georges, who sketched the first crocodile logo to be embroidered on the outer side of René's blazer. The jacket lit the flame to René's first invention in association with André Gillier, the biggest knitwear manufacturer at the time. The co produced the L1212 polo t-shirt, adorned with a crocodile on the chest. With its comfortable design, it enables more movement and perfectly absorbing perspiration. The t-shirt filed a patent, for the first time, a logo to appear on the other side of a piece of clothing, which later revolutionized the tennis sports dress code and fashion on a large part. During late 20s, Lacoste fell sick to a respiratory disease, causing him to step out of the court and shift his record on a aspiring, innovative journey. Regardless of the health condition, René's innovative resolve was still full. He invented the first tubular steel tennis racket, then licensed the patent to Wilson Sports Company, which was later endorsed to Jimmy Connors, who happened to win an astounding record of 3 Grand Slams in a row. And the reason was the racket's strong and light design, allowing swift and agile performance, again causing the main tennis sports equipment to be replaced forever. Speaking solutions, and much to his friends' amazement, effective 1927, Lacoste invented the first machine to launch tennis balls, to help him better his overhead and help other players with self-training. Rigorous René kept an ongoing string of innovations to file up around 20 patents between the 1960s and the 80s, mostly sports-centric items. By the same token, Lacoste was the first to create an apparel licensing model, which means obtaining permission from a company, a licensor, to another company, a licensee, to manufacture and sell one or more of its products within a defined market area. In this regard, Lacoste has those companies making its stuff, a business model that allows the licensees to create an extension of the brand in other countries, localized to the tastes and preferences of those specific regions. Eventually, upon a family feud, Lacoste and Devon Lee have an interesting partnership where Devon Lee owns 35% of Lacoste, and the latter owns 10% of Devon Lee, a strategy that allows Lacoste to maintain control over the design and ethics of the brand while not having to take care of the logistics and distribution. Up to this point, Lacoste is in thrive and business is doing alright. World War II broke out, disfiguring the physical form of the world, let alone business and the global economy. Trauma and dreadfulness for a solid 6 years, but nothing too good or too bad lasts forever. After the war is over, the white classic polos became colorful, as a way to ingrain hope and rejuvenate the brand's image. The colorful polos became a key aspiration to the interior design and marketing of the store till today. The monochromatic setting gave an impression that the brand is modern and vibrant. During the 80s, Lacoste was wading through murky waters of extensive distribution, battling for Americans' cash. Their products were distributed to department stores, including TJ Maxx and Target, which is below the brand's elite status, resulting in underestimating the brand's authenticity and what it stood for. Lacoste managed to take a step back from that, to recapture its premium status, by ending most of their licenses with many retailers and deploying the more expensive the better pricing strategy famous back in the time. It did work, and Lacoste re-established its premium image and drank considerable sales. The unique selling proposition serves Lacoste to some degree, but in the face of economic bubbles affecting people's consumption patterns, the cost of Lacoste products had to change. They had to find that sweet spot between making high quality garments and slightly affordable prices, in a time where more knockoff replicas uninvitedly joined in the polo club. If you build it, will they come? Well, indeed for Lacoste it was rivalry. Eponymous brands like Polo Ralph Lauren, Fred Perry, Tommy Hilfiger coming over with their core styles mimicking Lacoste heritage. And it is interesting to see how far those later brands got today with that inspiration, and how the fashion industry at large been symbolically reshaped by Lacoste genius approach to the rag trade. As an answer to the heated competition, the foresightedness of Bernard Lacoste aimed abroad. That right after India opened up to liberalization and globalization in 1991, the crocodile smelled opportunity and went overseas, making itself among the very first clothing brands to set foot in Bharatland. That when you go to urban cities in India today, you would notice a huge proportion of the population are dressed up in polos, an obvious evidence that Lacoste was one of the biggest factors to how India got exposed to modern apparel. Same scenario in other countries, by establishing the brand there and planting their seed way early and way ahead of its competitors. To so many, the polo t-shirt acts as a signifier of socio-economic class and a way of displaying individual identity. A liaison that was, and still the influence to Lacoste's past and future designs. Forward to the 2000s.
We're now down 43%.
What in the world is happening on Wall Street?
Actually, down by 4-5%.
The 2000s decade was challenging for the crocodile, facing an all-time high financial loss to fiercer competition and the fact of the youth finding the brand too aristocratic or old to resonate with. On the light of such events and Michel Lacoste taking over the helm of the brand, Lacoste decided to make significant investments in forms of signing new manufacturing and distribution licenses, new partnerships, and developing the material of the iconic shirt by upgrading to the Pima cotton, being the best of its kind to suit Lacoste quality standards, in addition to definitely appointing the sharp Robert C.C. Goh as a chairman in the States to keep a close eye on where Lacoste products were placed. Seagull managed to set up a special division called Propaganda Entertainment Marketing in LA, placing Lacoste and Lindsay Lohan in Mean Girls,
How? Your heart is wrong.
The cast of the teen drama The Orange County, and Gwyneth Paltrow in Wes Anderson's The Royal Tenenbaums. It was slow in coming, but later on, Business Week reported that Lacoste USA sales had soared to 1,000%. The brand had reinvented itself, and the US became one of its most profitable markets. Leading to campaigns, the launch of Un peu d'air sur terre, which was a little different from its earlier sports-centric and preppy image. The campaign was a milestone in Lacoste's advertising strategy, impacting the exposure, thus the revenue. These steps altogether gave way to an increase and reinvention of the brand as we see it today, but during that time, the goal of reaching the young isn't completely fulfilled. However, in the late 2000s was the appointing of Christophe Chinat as the CEO, a business guru who managed to put together a plan by commissioning a study with the Boston Consulting Group, and with Val's research methodology in mind, they came up with an idea, Lacoste Live, a label within a label as part of their segmentation strategy, coming out more colorful and vibrant in forms of events putting people together and getting the words out, redesigning the label into a mix of classic and street style, and worldwide collaborations with young creatives to represent the brand in their own way. Effective it was, the live result was a soaring $1.6 billion in revenue, equivalent to 14% growth, succeeding their positioning quest and making a huge appeal. Later that year, the brand launched Lacoste Lab, introducing anything from boomerangs, helmets, skis, you name it, to reassure the tradition of innovation, the integral part of the brand's DNA. The artifacts were designed by different experts in their respective fields, aiming by that approach to build a bridge or a portal between the brand's innovative heritage and its future. So from Chinat, the flame of targeting a young clientele is carried along by the current CEO Thierry Guibert, who revealed same beliefs by mentioning that this new era of fashion Lacoste is trying to explode his freedom of style. And to bring his conception to execution, who is better than Louis Trotter, being the first female creative director to acquire such a position within the brand, the current British designer being set to reinvent the design and look of the brand. As I saw in her first Lacoste collection, the show rolled in a dense green light reminiscent of the crocodile. The clothes, in a saturation of youthful colors, most of the Raff-like collection was with colors. With her minimalistic yet sophisticated craftiness, Trotter understood the Lacoste ritual of going fashion forward while keeping to brand's heritage. The contributions towards the environment and the community from Lacoste speaks volumes. Their CSR model is one of Lacoste's building blocks. In addition to the Save Your logo, last year in a collaboration with IUCN, the brand ran the Save Our Species campaign. The idea was to make awareness of endangered species by replacing the adorned crocodile by 10 most endangered species of the year and produce limited amount of polos. The number of shirts produced for each species corresponded to the estimated number of individuals remaining in the wild. More on good causes and social goals, there stands Lacoste Foundation, operating since 2006, which aims to help young people in France and in other countries to find their way in life through sport. Two Cliché, where they renovated Stade Racine tennis court in Paris, in our collaboration with local artists and made it free to access. We often get carried away from our core values and what we stood for under the pressure of concurrence. But Lacoste is one of those few brands that remains true to its label ethos. Now there must be some issues that happen here and there, which are inevitable in the business world. But on the long run, it is a brand that lives up to René Lacoste's ideals, that blends performance with invention, elegance with authenticity, and the notion of improving the community, the environment, and the era he lived in, and passing it along. René Lacoste was building a brand first of all around value, not profit, an impact, not a number, thinking about making a better world before making a bigger sell. Is Lacoste's message to aspiring startups to scrutinize and keep looking up to.